Hypothetical and biconditional propositions express hypothetical and biconditional relationships, which play a very important role in our logic. One thing that's interesting about our language is that there are many terms that can express hypothetical and biconditional relationships, but that don't use the words if-then or if and only if. In this section, we're going to examine a number of these terms and learn how they can be rewritten or translated into hypothetical or biconditional form. This in turn will help us to assess the validity of the arguments in which they appear. Now, the first thing that we need to do is to look at some important translation rules. The first rule is that the term being converted, whether it's entails or without or whatever, needs to drop out of the proposition entirely. In other words, if you have a proposition that says something like P entails Q, that's going to turn into an if-then statement, and the word entails is going to disappear. Related to that is that when we're translating these terms away, new translatable terms should not be introduced into the hypothetical or biconditional proposition that we're creating. So for example, if we're translating away the term have to, the term necessary shouldn't pop up in our new proposition. In learning how to translate these terms, we're going to introduce a number of translation schema. Each of these schema will use the Greek letters phi and psi. The reason that we do this is that if we use English letters, we can confuse ourselves because we know the ordinary order in which these letters appear. However, the letters phi and psi are probably unfamiliar to most of you, and so they're just random symbols. We'll see how this works with the first set of our terms, all, whenever, whatever, and whoever. Phi and psi in each of these stand for component parts of our propositions. So we could say all phi or psi, or whenever phi, psi, and so on. Now these four terms are actually quite easy to translate. All phi or psi becomes if phi then psi. Whenever phi, psi becomes if phi then psi, and so on. Let's look at a couple of examples that will make this more concrete. The first example is all dogs are mammals. Notice that if we say all dogs are mammals, that's equivalent to saying if it's a dog, then it's a mammal. Dogs in this instance is phi, mammals is psi. So all phi or psi became if phi then psi. Whenever it rains, my knee hurts becomes if it rains, then my knee hurts. So again, whenever phi psi has turned into if phi, then psi. Notice how in these translations, the words all and whenever have been translated away. They've been replaced by if then. Next, let's talk about the terms entails and implies. Phi entails psi, phi implies psi. These both become if phi then psi. When you say if phi then psi, you're really talking about an implication or an entailment relationship. For example, joining the military entails having much courage is the same thing as saying if you join the military, then you have much courage. Again, notice how the word entails has been translated away and replaced with if then. Without and unless are really interesting terms within our language. In particular, both of them mean if not. Thus, if we're going to translate them away, without phi psi becomes if not phi, then psi. And the same for unless. Here's an example. Without a passport, international travel is impossible. That's the same thing as saying, if you don't have a passport, then international travel is impossible. Notice how the word without has been replaced by the word if, and what goes into the antecedent, that is what immediately follows the word without, has been negated. Without then is the same thing as saying if not. Next we have necessary, sufficient, and necessary and sufficient. We've already talked about necessary and sufficient conditions in previous sections of this text. Here we're going to learn how they can be translated into if-then form. Now phi can be necessary for psi, It can also be sufficient for psi. It can also be necessary and sufficient for psi. As we've seen, sufficient conditions always appear in the antecedent of a hypothetical proposition, while necessary conditions appear in the hypothetical's consequent. Knowing this, the translation of these propositions is fairly straightforward. If phi is necessary for psi, then phi must go in the consequent. So the proposition becomes, if psi, then phi. On the other hand, if phi is sufficient for psi, then that becomes, if phi, then psi. Phi, the sufficient condition, is in the antecedent. And then predictably, if we combine necessary and sufficient conditions, that's the same thing as saying if and only if. So phi is necessary and sufficient for psi becomes phi if and only if psi. Again, let's look at an example. Water is necessary for life becomes if there's life, then there's water. The necessary condition, water, has to go into the consequent. The same idea applies if we're dealing with sufficient conditions. Next we have to or need to, and all you have to, and all you need to. So you have to phi for psi, and phi is all you have to do for psi. If you think about it, the terms have to and need to are really just different ways of saying necessary. So if you have to phi for psi, you're saying that phi is necessary for psi. By contrast, all you have to and all you need to are different ways of saying sufficient. So phi is all you have to do for psi is a way of saying that phi is sufficient for psi. Since we've just seen how to translate necessary and sufficient, the translations for have to, need to, and all you have to, all you need to become fairly straightforward. Specifically, you have to phi for psi becomes if psi, then phi. Remember, you have to phi means that phi is necessary, thus phi goes in the consequent. If phi is all you have to do, then it's sufficient, and so it goes in the antecedent. You have to apply to be admitted becomes if you're admitted, then you applied. To save our friendship, all you have to do is apologize becomes if you apologize, then you'll save our friendship. What you have to do goes in the consequent. All you have to do goes in the antecedent. Next we have only and the only. Remember from the section on biconditional syllogisms that whatever immediately follows only if goes in a hypothetical proposition's consequent. Well, the same applies if we have the word only by itself. Only phi or psi becomes if psi, then phi. But what's interesting is that if we put the word the in front of only, it changes around the logic. The only phi or psi becomes if phi, then psi. Let's look at some examples. If I say only motorized vehicles can ride on the freeway, that does not mean that all motorized vehicles can. For example, scooters might be banned. It would be wrong then to translate this as, if it's a motorized vehicle, then it can ride on the freeway. However, the proposition does mean that if something can ride on the freeway, then it's a motorized vehicle. This is the correct translation. Again, notice that whatever immediately follows only goes in the consequent. By contrast, if I say the only way to get promoted is through hard work, this is telling us that hard work is the only path to promotion. There's no guarantee, however, that hard work will earn somebody a promotion. In translating the proposition then, the only way to get promoted is through hard work becomes if someone gets promoted, then they worked hard. Whatever immediately follows the term the only is going to be a sufficient condition. Thus, it goes in the antecedent of the hypothetical. So again, putting the word the in front of only flips its logic. Now what about all and only? Sometimes we say all and only phi or psi. Notice how this sounds a lot like if and only if. All and only phi or psi is the conjunction of two things. all phi are psi, and only phi are psi. Remember that we've already seen how to translate each of these. All phi are psi becomes if phi then psi. Only phi are psi becomes if psi then phi. So if we conjoin them, all and only phi are psi becomes phi if and only if psi. If I say all and only students enrolled in the class can take the exam, that's the same thing as saying you can take the exam if and only if you're a student enrolled in the class. Incidentally, it would not be wrong to say you're a student enrolled in the class if and only if you can take the exam, but this would sound odd. It's important to be able to recognize these terms because they appear frequently in arguments. Being able to translate them and translate them easily will thus go a long way toward being able to assess the validity of the arguments in which they appear.